it's true, 'cause you got me, baby, I got you. Hey, I got you, babe. I got you, babe. They say our love won't pay the rent, for it's earned, our money's all been spent.
All right, bye. This is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical, and today's webcast or podcast is going to be about hepatitis in general and hepatitis C in particular. And we'll be joined by Dr. Ikishima and his patient, Daryl Burge. And Daryl and his wife, Barbara, will be sharing with us a pretty incredible story for what's, you know, generally considered an incurable disease, or at least a very difficult one to cure. So let's just get on the same page for what the liver is and what it does. The liver is a critical organ. It filters pretty much all the blood coming back from the body before it goes to the heart and gets pumped out again. So it's like a big pool filter. It's a Swiss Army knife of sorts. It does a little bit of everything. It even makes the blood cells when you're a fetus, but that gets taken over by the bone marrow later. It filters 2 liters of blood at 99% efficiency. It detoxifies everything, and I mean everything, and excretes it into the intestinal tract, a bunch of different chemical reactions. It's very critical for storage of glycogen, which are like, unlike glucose, which is a simple sugar molecule that you use like $1 bills, glycogen is like $20 bills. So it's not like a savings bond or traveler's check like fat. That you have to do a little work to cash out. But glycogen is ready to go. And it makes cholesterol, fats, it makes the clotting factor. So people with liver disease often have bleeding disorders. They don't clot well. It makes all the albumin, which is the protein which keeps your blood the proper concentration. If not, you can get swelling of the legs and puffiness. So albumin is just critical also. It also makes bile salts, which is what, not to be confused with bilirubin, which is the breakdown product of hemoglobin. Bile salts are like this cholesterol-related thing which gets excreted through the bile and forms little soap bubbles around fat. So when you eat a fatty meal, the bile coats it and allows it to be absorbed into the intestinal tract, because usually fat wouldn't cross that easily. It converts ammonia, which is a waste product of metabolism, to urea. So people with liver failure often get, you know, dizzy. They get, you know, anemia problem or ammonia problems. They get lightheaded. It stores vitamin A for up to 2 years, vitamin B12 for up to 3 years, vitamin D for up to 4 months, and it stores all kinds of heavy metals like iron and copper. It also is one of the steps in the angiotensin system, which, along with the kidney, regulates your blood pressure. So the liver does it. This is a diagram of what happens when you get liver injury. You have these stellate cells, which are responsible for mediating the immune response, controlling it, keeping it under wraps, and bringing the proper cells. There's inflammatory cells that come in. There's these special macrophage-like cells or immune cells of the reticular endothelial system. And then you got these oval cells, which are, like over here, we talk always about differentiation. So when you're a fertilized egg, you can become everything. And every step that you gain more specificity, you lose the ability, the potency, as well as the... What we're talking about here is a bipotent cell. Oval cells can become both hepatocytes and biliary cells, which are just distinct type of cells. These are the working little factories of the liver, and these are the ones that make these channels called the bile duct system and secrete the bile, which is, again, used for absorbing fat, which is so critical. The symptoms of hepatitis, moving to the clinical, are very nonspecific. Many people will get it and they'll not even know it. They're just nonspecific viral symptoms such as malaise, or headaches, nausea, fever, diarrhea, vomiting, and body aches. Something particular to this condition could be itching, which probably is primarily due to the bile salt accumulation. and not so much the bilirubin. Bile salts cause itching through an interaction, I think, with the opioid receptor. And it's a common thing. I used to practice OBGYN, and women get this thing called cholestasis of pregnancy, which causes terrible body itching. And that's exactly for that reason. The bile is not moving. It gets built up. You can also get pale stools, because if the liver is dysfunctional, it's not excreting the bilirubin. That's the breakdown of the hemoglobin. And what I mean by that, it has to be conjugated. It has to be bound to another molecule to be excreted, because it's not usually able to get into the intestines. So if you have no liver function, you're not conjugating your bilirubin. It's not becoming water-soluble and getting to the gut, and your poop is pale, which is a weird symptom. The dark urine comes if you get a buildup of bilirubin and it gets excreted into the urine. This is, which is not to say that if you have dark urine, you have liver failure. No, but this is one of the things that could be associated. Increased bilirubin also shows up as jaundice here in the eyes. So, again, the newborns, they have a problem with bilirubin because their livers are not mature, and oftentimes they can't conjugate or make water-soluble the regular bilirubin, and it builds up and can become quite dangerous and pigment the brain and cause brain damage. So the liver is a critical organ, and we just can't live without it, but it's a remarkably resilient organ as well. It can regenerate even under terrible circumstances, which is why a lot of the research into hepatitis, I think, is a little misdirected. Everyone knows that the life history of hepatitis, if it's chronic, will lead to cirrhosis. And cirrhosis is preceded by a fatty infiltrate of liver, okay? And then the healing, the inflammation, the repair leads to fibrosis or scar tissue, replacing normal cells, which if continues, leads to cirrhosis, which just means the liver turns into this petrified, nodular block of scar tissue. And cirrhosis is a precursor to liver cancer. That's bad, and we know that from Hep B, Hep C primarily, but also alcoholic hepatitis. This is the way that it usually goes, unless you can clean up your act or reverse the process, which it is very reversible. Again, the liver very, very well healing itself. So what's the cause of hepatitis? Well, just briefly, there's a bunch of things that people commonly take that can be toxic. The most important is alcohol, of course. Alcoholism is a big problem for many, and it's something that tends to be lifelong exposure, whereas, you know, if a teenager tries to kill themselves with Tylenol, that can cause liver failure, but again, they're not probably going to do that every night of the week, you know, while watching Johnny Carson. So, they also have problems. Birth control pills rarely could do that. Claritin, which is an over-the-counter lorantidine, and ibuprofen, although usually kills the kidney, can also do damage, again, because the liver's got that universal detoxification system. Isoniazid is a tuberculosis medicine, fungal medicines ending in azole, myconazole, all those things, acne medications, minocycline, bladder antibiotic, nitrofurantoin, AZT for AIDS. These are all pretty toxic. Cardiac medications, people often take nifedipine, also Aldomet, and amiodarone, which is a drug related to controlling abnormal cardiac rhythm. People take a lot of Dilantin and valproic acid. And there's also other drugs that often are used in autoimmune diseases, or they're called azathioprine, methotrexate, allopurinol for gout. And general anesthesia, again, it's a limited, but halothane can also cause a liver failure. Metabolic, genetic, you have congenital problems. Common ones are, or well-known ones, are primary biliary cirrhosis, primary sclerosing cholangitis, hemochromatosis, buildup of iron, Wilson's, buildup of copper, and alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. Also, the most common, I think, in this country and every country with a lot of carbs is the fatty liver, non-alcoholic fatty liver. So basically, if you're heavy, you get fat everywhere, including your liver. There are other disease theories, but I think that's pretty much the story there. I also, before I took TA65, was 210, and my BMI was probably near 30, and I had a fatty liver. My LFTs were in the low 110s, not due to any other cause other than just being fat, which was due to not really worrying about exercise or diet. But as a result of losing 30 pounds and perhaps some cellular changes from the TA, I'm now 175, and my fatty liver is gone, which is good. There's also various forms of autoimmune disease that can cause hepatitis chronically. And in particular, there are certain autoimmune diseases that can cause hepatitis, which are specific to the liver. Autoimmunity, as you recall, is just antibodies made to your own stuff, often to DNA components or what have you. And when your body starts attacking your own cells, of course, that's a problem. Lastly, what we're really talking about here, I finally got into it 10 minutes in, is what we're talking about is infectious hepatitis, the ABCs. Just to get out of the way, there are other ways to get hepatitis. There's tick-borne diseases like Rocky Mountain spotted fever, mosquito-borne, such as the yellow fever, toxoplasmosis, which is often in cat feces if you have cats, or eating raw meat. Schistosomiasis is a tropical parasite which can get into the liver. And then the herpes viruses, HSV, CMV, Epstein-Barr. This is herpes, CMV, and the chronic fatigue disease, infectious mononucleosis, also known as. These kind of viruses are interesting. They're all cousins, and they all integrate into your DNA. And we're learning now that they cause a lifelong challenge to your immune system, which is described a lot in Podcast 2, What is Aging, around minute 1446. So the herpes viruses may be actually causal in a lot of grinding down of the immune system, which is related and part and parcel of aging. Hep A is just a throwaway in a sense. Hep A is just related to fecal oral transmission, just clean water or lack thereof. Usually there are no clinical signs or symptoms in over 90%, and having the disease confers lifelong immunity, although rarely people do develop fulminant hepatitis and even chronic failure from that. B is a huge problem. I mean, it's one, if you can believe it, one out of three people in the world have been infected. 2 billion people. And currently, the chronicity, the people with the chronic carrying, is 400 million, or 2 deaths per minute. So if you do the math, basically, that tells you that 90% of adults will recover and be immune, which is maybe something we didn't know. Infants, on the other hand, get 90% chronic infections, and they are at a lifetime 40% risk of cirrhosis and then cancer, hepatocellular carcinoma. And Hep B is 100 times more infectious than HIV. It can be transmitted sexually, through blood, and also possibly through close contact. Treatments for Hep B include interferon, which is an aim to stimulate the immune system like TA65. It can make people sick, as Daryl will explain later. And I liken it to throwing lighter fluid on a fire without building the fire, without setting the kindle and getting everything to grow. Because interferon is a potent cytokine. It's an immune messenger that's part of the cascade of starting up a big ruckus and trying to clear a bad thing. And so that's one way to go, but perhaps not the best. Natural immunity is the best. But Hep surface antigen vaccine, which is commonly now given to newborns, doesn't work if you're already infected. You can give gamma globulins to hope to bind up the particles, but this is much better a preventive measure and should be probably universally given in infants. Another way that people have tried are these families of anti-reverse transcriptases. So reverse transcriptase, again, if you go to Podcast 2, is explained. It's just taking RNA and going to DNA instead of the reverse, which is the usual, DNA to RNA. But remember, reverse transcriptase, one of the most prevalent and important ones is telomerase. So perhaps you're inhibiting that as well. Who knows? And it's only because Hep B is unusual. It uses a sneaky way of taking its RNA or DNA and making it integrate and actually be copied by the host cell. All right, so let's get to the heart of the matter here. It's Hep C. Okay, A, no biggie. B, huge problem. But C is, again, a different family, a different disease pathology, and you can't lump them together. C is a blood-borne disease. Okay, sexual transmission is unlikely, perhaps even approaching zero transmission, which I did not know until doing this research. Unless, of course, there's open sores or tears or something like that. The risk of transfusion-related Hep C in the U.S. is quite small. There hasn't been a case in greater than 10 years. And while we're on the subject, HIV transmission in the U.S. blood supply has only occurred once in the last 9 years, so it's very, very safe in this country, although perhaps not in countries such as Bali, as we'll find out. The vertical transmission, or transmission from mother to baby, is only 6%, whereas it can be as high as 20% with Hep B. And chronic infection is the opposite. We remember it was only 10% from Hep B infection, 90% get immune for life, whereas with Hep C, two-thirds of people become chronic carriers. And as when they become carriers, the ability to cure it is less than 1%. So Hep C is pretty much, unless you can be in this 1%, it's highly likely to be a chronic infection. And because of that process, it's highly likely to cause cirrhosis and then liver cancer along the way. So in all seriousness, I would much rather have HIV infection than Hep C, because HIV can be controlled, even to the point of having no detectable virus, whereas Hep C currently is not considered a curable disease, and the pathway is quite predictable and poor. All right, so as we always have to, we go through a little literature search. You know, before your eyes glaze over, this will be pretty painless. Just wanted to show again, as we always show every week, that the medical literature is there, and it shows that telomere erosion, it's all at the heart of these diseases, hepatitis being no exception. So if you'll just go into the archives of 1 through 10 and the next 10 after that, you'll always get these slides, and this is just part and parcel of what we do every week. So going back to 1996, someone was already measuring telomere changes in hepatocellular carcinoma and hepatitis virus-infected livers. And, of course, chromosome instability by telomere loss, they thought, played a role. Again, go to podcast 2 to learn more about that. In all their samples, they showed that compared with the non-cancerous liver tissue, or compared with the virus-free tissue, the telomeres were shorter. Of course, this was interesting, but not interesting enough to really pursue. Again, from 96, another study out of Japan showing that the cancer niche was shorter than the neighboring niches. And remember, we talked about this concept of niches, like a liver is a particularly good example of perhaps little neighboring beehives. So there's a queen bee in the middle, and all the drones are derived from her, and so they're as bad or as old as she is. So what this interesting study showed is that if you take a liver and you sample the cancer versus the surrounding hives, the unaffected hives, the surrounding ones, the queen and drones, were 8,800 base pairs. But the one from the diseased little segment was 5,400 base pairs. So this is consistent with the idea that there's a monoclonal, meaning they all follow the queen, and the damage comes to that queen stem cell. And they're saying perhaps telomere shortening is not only an associated finding, but is also a cause of the development of hepatocellular carcinoma. which is something we're finding in all the disease states. It's pretty much the same wheel being discovered by everyone around the world in their own pet diseases, that telomere erosion confers a higher risk of cancer. But you have to be careful, because if you do studies too much after the fact, you actually find that telomerase activation is a feature that the cell uses to try and heal itself. And once it does, you can get all things crazy. You can get a lot of wide variation. You get long, long telomeres as some of the cells are trying to heal. So if you sample late in the disease, you find that it's not this consistent gradual decline, but it's just total helter-skelter. 2000, another clue was overlooked, telomere reduction in human liver tissue with age and chronic inflammation. Again, the same study, again, reinventing the wheel. They found that with liver cirrhosis and compared to normal liver, the telomere short. And this goes back to the idea of the fact that when you use, abuse, and cause inflammation, any cells in replication, you get worsening. This cell, or this study, is kind of like an easy study to do, because they just drew people's white blood cells, as we measure your telomeres if you come in, and they found that these T helpers, these CD4 cells, the telomere length was shorter, and the shorter the length, the worse the fibrosis, the worse the portal, the liver inflammation, the worse the clotting times, and the higher the bilirubin. So an important thing in determining causality is gradient. So how do we know something is causing something and not merely associated with it? Well, the worse the suspect, the worse the telomere shortening, then the proportionally worse the clinical sign. Turning now to Hep C in particular, this study from 2008 showing that hepatocyte turnover, again, replicative senescence, is the primary mechanism of telomere shortening in Hep C, and that white blood cells from people with chronic C had shorter telomeres than people who are either healthy or in remission. There's evidence that a stem cell origin might be at play in the hepatocellular carcinoma. So what I like to say is that, you know, a stem cell, a queen bee, is like Superman or Lex Luthor. It's got special immortal powers, whereas a regular cell is Jimmy Olsen. It's going to die, and it doesn't have those powers. So here's some evidence showing that perhaps there's a stem cell origin of hepatocellular carcinoma. Now, I think it's a debate that will not be settled. If you ask oncologists, is there such a thing as a cancer stem cell, it's 50-50, and it's been like that since the emergence of this theory maybe 6 or 7 years ago. And the reason why, basically, if I could digress a little bit, my bias is that it's easier to cause an immortal stem cell to be damaged and then make a bunch of cancer stem cells from that than it is to take an already damaged, run-of-the-mill differentiated cell, de-differentiate it, or create the exact precise errors required to have a cancer. I mean, you know, it's probably true either way, but the liver presents an interesting model because de-differentiation is such an integral part of the repair of the liver. In podcast 5, we talked to Dr. Michael West, world expert in stem cell biology, and he introduced, at the introduction of Dr. Dave Wynarski, the concept of senestatic activation, which was something I had not heard of. It was basically the idea that when cells become damaged, they are hitting the gas and they're hitting the brakes at the same time. So they're no longer able to copy themselves because of DNA damage. The P53 or other mechanisms keep that cell from making copies, so that's the brakes. But they're also in a highly activated state, so that's the gas. And as a result, they're pouring out all these inflammatory mediators or cytokines, and that's mobilizing a lot of tissue destruction, collagenase, hyaluronidase, things that just kind of turn the surrounding extracellular space into goo. Because part of the process of inflammation, if you've ever had an abscess, you understand that the inflammation is necessary to dissolve and break up and get all the bad stuff in the same area so that the white blood cells can form pus around it, a capsule around it, kill it. Well, that's kind of a double-edged sword in terms of the liver inflammation. So the old model was that there's this thing, again, all that was relevant because of the TIMP. TIMP is tissue inhibitor of metalloproteinase. Okay, so what does that mean? Metalloproteinase are these enzymes with metals in them, like zinc, which dissolve tissue. It's like, you know, the soap that comes in when you have a serious infection to dissolve everything, which is the mediator, the mechanism of this SAM static activation described in podcast 5. So there's people who believe that all these ages of disease, or these diseases of aging, are inflammatory related. Well, back in 2002, people thought that TIMP, which is this tissue inhibitor of this destructive process, was inhibiting apoptosis. Apoptosis is programmed cell death. So basically, they knew from kind of their reductionist view that when you recover from liver fibrosis, the HSC, in this case this stands for hepatic stellate cell, which are these immune modulator little firemen, that they go away when you're recovering from liver fibrosis. Okay. So as a result, the TIMP, the tissue inhibitor of metalloproteinase, comes in, and they thought that that was what was decreasing the stellate cells. But it's more like this. Does a fireman winding up their hoses cause the fires? No. When the firemen wind up their hoses, the fire is over. Okay? So the TIMP, in this analogy, if you allow me, is like the sirens that bring more firemen. So the TIMP is not the problem. And these people are saying, well, maybe if we do something against the TIMP, then we won't have as many stellate cells and we won't have this fibrosis. I'm not. Expert in this field. In fact, I just came to it last night at midnight, but it seems to me that in light of this new research, which is just my speculation, could be totally wrong, this is 2011, yet to be published, that they're saying that TIMP is the autocrine signal to bring more hepatic stellate cells. Okay, so let's look here. We have revealed a novel autocrine mitogenic effect of TIMP on HSC. Okay, what does that mean? Autocrine means a hormone that's secreted to influence itself or its own cell type. Mitogenic means to cause increased proliferation or mitosis. And TIMP on HSC. So that means that the HSC, the stellate cells, when there's an inflammation, they put out a fire alarm. And they say, hey, we need more firemen over here, which causes these cells to proliferate. It causes more and more of them to divide. Okay? So, basically, I think the correct model is that TIMP is the signal to bring more firemen to the area. And that when the sentence here is, inhibiting matrix degradation means keeping the liver inflammation from melting the liver. TIMPs, it's thought, promote fibrosis by inhibiting the matrix degradation, apoptosis of HSC. Well, I already think that the apoptosis is backwards, you know, But the TIMP, these little inhibiting proteins, they inhibit matrix degradation. So in my thinking, perhaps this is not a way of causing an exuberant response, but a controlled response. Because instead of getting a diffuse abscess of the liver and destruction, you're getting a kind of tempered response. So you're inhibiting the matrix degradation. So yeah, you're getting the firemen in, they're coming in, and they're trying to control, to wall off the fire and not let the fire get out of control. So that's just my speculation. I think that the thinking perhaps is not correct now, that if this is true, that TIMP is an autocrine signal, it has an effect to bring more firemen in, then perhaps the liver is adapted to keep from eating itself, much like the pancreas. And we see the same thing in the pancreatic stellate cells. Because, you know, the pancreas is a soapy organ, and if you get pancreatitis, the organs start to dissolve itself. That's all bad. So it's kind of an analogous system, something that maybe will be researched. Anyway, boring. So let's go to the history, the clinical history. which is Daryl's history, which is much more interesting. All right, so Daryl Burge is a 52-year-old painter, sculptor, general creator from Long Island, and he has had some alcohol consumption in the past, but never to the point of alcoholism. Not a drug user, but he does travel for importing Balinese art. And Bali, is, as you might know, is, although part of Indonesia, not a Muslim country, but predominantly a Hindu country, and they produce some very intricate and beautiful art. So his mission is to import and export those works for other people to enjoy. At age 39, he had a motorcycle accident in Bali, and his femur was shattered in three places. And he underwent surgery. He doesn't think he was transfused, but perhaps the sterilization of the instruments was not the greatest. Who knows? Don't want to cast aspersions, but there's certainly many opportunities for Hep C, which is a widely prevalent disease, to have been transmitted to him during an extensive surgery like that. He met Barbara in Bali 2 years later, just by kismet, and they fell in love and were married. And she recalls, after speaking with him the other day, that he was itchy even when they first met. So there could have been some Hep C incubating at that time as well. At the time, she thought, well, because her sister had battled alcoholic hepatitis and had some whole body itching, it could have been hepatitis. But it wasn't to the point where it was really investigated until 2007, when the itching became all-consuming. And so they went to see dermatologists who, they didn't do a biopsy, but they gave steroid creams. They even gave some benzodiazepines for relaxation, because Daryl couldn't sleep, which really kind of knocked him out, because again, he's a lightweight, he's not used to drugs or anything like that, so that was quite difficult for him to deal with. And then he would have to put shea butter on himself, this kind of cream, all over his body before he went out, and it was a daily, constant ritual. He got blisters on his arms, which were like blowholes, scabs that needed to be picked, and then the blood had sort of an orange tint. Again, Barbara insisted, maybe this is a liver thing. We should check it out. They went to see a GI doctor after Barbara's insistence indeed discovered or led to the discovery of elevated liver function or hepatitis. So she was right about that, even though the doctor didn't think so and the dermatologist didn't think so either. So the GI doctor with the hepatitis went for a cause and did a liver biopsy, found pre-cirrhosis, or a pretty bad disease there, chronic disease. No nodules from the imaging, so no cancer. That's the next shoe you wait to drop. But didn't really resolve the issue of the ferritin, other than saying that the usual causes of high iron or ferritin storage, they're called hemochromatoses, that was not there. So there was no genetic hemochromatosis, and that's where the search ended. But that's not where Daryl's suffering ended. He continued to use steroids, Xanax, and it led to, you know, sadness, depression. I mean, he could not lead a normal life, and it was difficult for him, both in terms of the sleep and the anxiety and just the general existential hell that he was in. So, here's Daryl, I think 2009. In 2008, they did a Frank Lloyd Wright treatment of diet and special, very specific treatments to prevent Hep C, which apparently they felt didn't have any effect. And then in 2009, they did the interferon. The alpha interferon, again, is this potent inflammatory mediator, 4 months. But Daryl says it felt like he got on the wrong bus from the get-go. It was very, very hard to tolerate. And if we zoom in on his hand in this picture, it's really not the greatest, but you could see there are depigmented areas. There's little scabs in various stages of healing and sores. But, you know, it's probably, I don't know how much he's suffering in this picture, but he looks pretty happy with the hose and everything. But I think this is just one of the rare pictures. They went ahead and threw out almost all the other pictures they had from this whole era because they reminded them of just how much suffering he was going through. asked him, could you produce a slide or a picture where he looks terrible? And they said, well, no, we destroyed all of them, which is, I think, perfectly understandable. So enter a friend of theirs, Gilbert Levy, who's known Dr. Mikishima for 20 years. And Dr. Shima is one of the early pioneers of T65. And along with me, he started way back in 2008 to give it to patients. And they said, well, talk to this guy. You know, Dr. Shima knows a lot about the immune system. He has a lot of chronically ill patients. He has different modalities of complementary medicine. And so they did that. Like the day after interferon failed, they just said, heck, let's get out of here and go to Shima. So they went to see Dr. Shima in Corte Madera. And they felt like after he started on the T65, it was like walking out of a closet. It was pretty dramatic. And within 2 weeks, his skin had healed. He had some warts that had gone away. And the liver spots, the crusty scabs all over his body, would just literally rub off, which is kind of remarkable. And 3 months later, they were on a beach in Goa, continuing more of their physical and mental healing. Barb had been press secretary for the Dalai Lama for many years, so he's very comfortable in that culture. And so they went from him being depressed and really on the point of just wit's end for years, and in 3 months, they were on a beach in Goa, and he was feeling pretty much normal. Okay, so, all right, well, this lovely, lovely lady, the young lady is Barbara, 57 years young, and this young man, 52, is Daryl. And he looks probably as good as he did in the hose picture. Are you guys there?
Yes, we are.
Yeah, great. How are you?
Me too.
Hello.
Did you guys understand that, a lot of that, or was it just too much?
Yes.
Yep.
Science-y stuff.
The one thing was, it's Lloyd Wright, not Frank Floyd Wright.
Okay.
One's an architect.
There's typos. At 1 in the morning, there's typos, my brother. You know, all right. Well, I dig your Notre Dame shirt or whatever that is. It's pretty cool.
That's actually a picture of my snakes.
Say what?
I raise snakes.
Are we looking at the same picture? Because I see like a mandala, like stained glass thing on your chest.
Yeah, it's a mandala. It's all baby snakes.
Oh, get out of here.
Wow. Yeah, we made this mandala.
You sure you don't do drugs, right? That's...
No, we made it on the Photoshop.
I'm kidding. If you have this in your mind, then you probably don't need to do drugs like other people.
My husband is a photographer.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And I had all these great pictures of you. Oh, here. Look at the craftsman. This guy's a factotum here. So here's you framing a house after you got on TA-65.
Yeah, that's our pool house.
This looks like a Frank Lloyd Wright house. What is this?
It's the pool house.
Nice. So you made that?
He built it with his friend and I helped. And that was when he was on TA-65. He had so much energy. It's just a miracle.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, my itch was so, you know, so intense that I didn't know, you know, then I tried everything I could think of, and I, you know, was dousing myself in shea butter, and you know, when you're talking about the scabs and stuff in my arms, there was, you know, places where my body would itch, you would think an alien was coming out of me, but there was absolutely, my skin didn't look, have any sign whatsoever that there was anything wrong. You know, I would itch everywhere like that. There's only some places where that actually would scratch to where I would bleed, you know, and those places on my arms were like hot spots, and I usually had to keep the scabs open because it would seem like it relieved the tension of the itch. I don't know how, but my whole body itched, and like I said, I took the Xanax I only took it at night to go to sleep, and you know, and then after I took the TA, like I said, my skin, you know, my itch stopped, and my scab stopped, and all these little liver spots, he's like you said, just scraped off. And every, you know, just slowly every day, my skin just has been getting better and better and better. And, and people, you know, that I don't even know, you know, comes will touch my back or something, wow, you've got such soft skin, you know. Like, oh, my God, you should have seen me a year ago. I was all like a...
He looked like an old lizard, his skin, and now he's like a... 20-year-old man. His skin is so soft, and it's not itching, and this is like life-changing for us.
My itch is now completely gone. I don't even put lotion on anymore.
Now, when you guys met, and Barbara said, hey, this could be hepatitis.
She just thought it had something to do with my liver because her sister, you know, was bulimic and a very heavy alcoholic, and her liver was really damaged, and she itched and kind of explained it the same way, like the itch would just drive her nuts, you know. And
she attempted to suicide 5 times because of her itch.
That's why Barbara thought that it must have something to do with my liver. So I went and got blood tests, and they came back fine until Barbara said, check his liver, you know, more exclusively, and that's when they called back and said, oh, yeah, you've got hepatitis C. I go, it takes a lot of it.
That's the kind of the crazy thing about this story is that Barbara is like so much ahead of the 3 dermatologists and the internist and the GI doctor. It's like, I mean, I think there's a tendency as professionals to say, well, that's nice that you read about that on the internet, but, you know, I'm the doctor, so. But,
yeah, because the last blood test I had when I was on the phone and she said, oh, everything's fine, Barbara just went, no, that's impossible. You check his liver again. It was like, wow. She just like screamed at him. And
where do you get the confidence and the moxie to stand up to these educated medical professionals? How do you say to them?
Well, I have been just in a hospital. I had a car accident, and I know about hospitals. But, you know, the doctor refused. She said, it's impossible. And after he had tests for eczema done, and he went to so many doctors, I said, you know, it's enough now, you have to check his liver. Impossible, he's a healthy man, look, he's healthy, and because he has no jaundice, his joints didn't ache, and he has a bad liver already. I mean, pre-cirrhosis, from 0 to 4, he's on a 3.5. That was 3 years ago at the last biopsy. So we know he was already bad, but the doctor refused to take the test.
Well, and I see also that they never check the bile salts, which is actually the thing that's causing the itching. It's not the bilirubin that most people would think. It's the bile salts. And that's something we check a lot during pregnancy when women come itching. So, yeah, I mean, that's...
I changed the filter on my water, you know, I mean, everything, you know.
We tried everything. We tried if it was the water. We got a different water system in the house.
Yeah.
No more soap. I mean, we tried. I mean, my husband was sometimes crying. Sorry, I speak for him, but he doesn't remember because now he is so good, and when you are so good, you forget how bad you have been. But he was sitting here crying, and he said, Barbara, I'm a freak. I cannot travel anymore. I have to cream my body 20 times a day with shea butter. That was the only relief.
Everybody said I stink like old milk.
he smelled like shea butter. He didn't leave the house anymore. It was very devastating.
So this is one of the only pictures you could find from that time.
Yeah, like I said, I got rid of them all. I mean,
unfortunately, yes. And this picture, I mean, the original is a little better, I can see. But I got this from Germany for my sister, sending this picture, and they sent it back. I deleted it.
Right, because all the ones in your possession had been destroyed.
No, he said, please delete them, yeah. I mean, there is nothing we have not tried, seriously.
But now he looks kind of, looks like it could be a different person than the later picture. I got confused about the sequence. So obviously he's wearing his hair differently. And we get...
when I was so sick with the interferon, I figured, you know what, I might as well just shave my head and look like I'm dying.
Well, not this guy. But this was...
I just wanted to look the part, you know. I've never, you know.
I hear you. I mean,
I had never done it. I figured I had to do it once, you know.
So is this is a more recent photo then?
Yeah.
That's remarkable. You look like that guy's younger brother.
Yeah.
That's weird. So do you feel like your skin in general is in a good shape, even better than Bali?
Better than it's ever. I mean, then I can, you know, of course you don't remember when you're in your 20s or 30s because, you know, everything's fine, you know what I mean? But it's better than I can ever remember in 15 years at least.
If I could just mention something about the itch, this itching. My sister, she has this since a long time, liver failure, and she attempted suicide 5 times because she cannot take the doctor told her it is compatible to the highest degree of pain. And sometimes she had this itch for like 4 days. She has it almost every day, but 4 days continuously. She is so worn out. She can't sleep. It is so bad. And my husband had it almost as bad. And that's why I insisted so much. I mean, his nerves were so shattered. He couldn't concentrate anymore. It was so damaging, his nerves, everything.
Well, it sounds like such a trivial thing. Oh, you have an itch. Oh, what's the big deal? But when it's consuming your consciousness 24 hours a day, it is like a torture.
And it's not really an itch. It's more like a electrical burn grabbing, you know, like a you know. I couldn't really say it was itch, you know, because it was more like it came up and squeezed and grabbed you, you know what I mean?
Well, you know, it's really...
It actually was more like a, you know...
Yeah, it's not a cutaneous phenomenon, so it's more a central opioid phenomenon. It's the bile salts are interacting with your central nervous system to make you feel like you have to itch, I think. Oh. How many years were you with the Dalai Lama, Barbara?
25 years I was in Asia, and I did once a 3 years walk with 60 monks, Buddhist monks, to every Buddhist country over a period of 3 years. So these monks, they did a peace walk for world peace, and His Holiness the Dalai Lama initiated it, and I... walked with the monks, got visas for the monks. I managed this whole event. I was a press agent, and these monks were walking through 60 countries, and I joined them and slept in monasteries for 3 years and lived with 60 monks walking around the world for world peace. That's what
they
did.
Wow, that's truly amazing.
Things.
So just with a bunch of bald-headed Dharma bums, huh?
First I had to go to all these countries. I chose the monks, got passports for them, visas for every country, and it was a very interesting time.
Those monks are nice people, aren't they?
Yep. Very happy and pure and innocent. I love it.
Yeah. Okay, but it looks pretty fluffy there. I mean, maybe it's just the halo, the backlighting.
Yeah, I haven't gotten any new hair, but it just seems to be thicker.
Thicker, exactly. That's what I would expect. Thicker, and the color can be darker as well. Have you noticed any change in the color? No.
Yeah, I'm going gray.
No, very,
two little spots.
He has two little hair, and he's freaking out that he's getting gray.
It's 52. Well, you. What about you, Barb? Are you wearing dreadlocks here? What's going on here?
Yes, I do.
Nice.
And I dye my hair.
It's a good look. You look... like four non-blondes, or what is that group? The gal. Looks good.
Green hair when I met her.
So she's got a very unique,
bright green.
Unique approach to living, I think. So are you both monks? I mean, are you both Tibetan Buddhists, or just one of you, or half of you?
No, we're Buddhists.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We're Buddhists.
No, Buddhas.
Not necessarily of the Tibetan school, though.
Generally. No. I had once a talk with His Holiness and about religion, and I told him that I don't specially believe in religion and I don't have a religion, but I feel most happy in a Buddhist country. And the Dalai Lama was laughing and he said, "Baba, you are a true Buddhist."
Yeah, right. I know. It's got to take the religion out of the building, right? So.
Did you ever hear of Bhagwan Shri Rajneesh?
I have heard of Bhagwan.
Yeah, well, I was just a photographer for 8 years.
Really?
In India, living in the commune.
Oh my God, you're kind of reminding me of Dennis Hopper in Apocalypse Now. So you're falling around the
I've heard that before.
Yeah, my husband was the school's personal photographer, and he lived for 8 years there. In
that's too funny. All right, well, my wife has just written me an angry note saying we should stick to TA, so let's stick to TA. All right, so you look, Barbara, you took it for 6 months. Daryl, you look fabulous. And how's the energy, the sleep?
Great.
Are you sleeping well?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, like I said, I stopped the Xanax, and I went through a week of not sleeping. And then I went I think psychologically, since I took it at night, I guess it wasn't so bad as it was for a lot of people I've seen on the internet of kicking Xanax. But I didn't sleep for a little while, but now I'm fine, and it's been nine months.
Yeah, which kind of speaks to our last webinar last week was about
almost
sleep.
A year since I haven't taken it.
Yeah, I mean, well, we discussed sleep last week and talked about the fact that things like Xanax can really disrupt your sleep brainwaves, but then there's also withdrawal. So did you have trouble coming off Xanax?
Yeah. I felt kind of a little bit crazy, and I felt like when I would turn my head, my vision wouldn't catch up really quite as quick, and then in sleeping, I felt like I was starting to dream again, and I felt like I was getting these huge chunks of my consciousness back that I didn't even know I had lost, you know?
Yeah,
and my doctors, nobody ever told me that this drug was so heavy. I just thought it was I was actually pretty impressed that it had no side effects, you know.
Well, like any psychotropic drug, you need to taper. But that's one good thing about TA-65. There is no psychotropic effect. You don't get drowsy or any kind of euphoria. So you can start
nothing. I mean, it doesn't bother my stomach or anything.
Nothing. There's nothing, yeah.
It just makes you feel very clear, you know.
What other things have you noticed in terms of your clarity, your mood, your thinking, anything else, your outlook?
Yeah, I just seem sometimes I get these. Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, I'm not itching, but yeah, sometimes I just feel like brilliantly clear, you know?
Right. Yeah, I hear that. I hear the dreaming is deeper and more vivid. And
yeah,
more
I guess that has to do with Xanax too, but yeah, like I say, you know, I haven't missed. I don't know how or why, but somehow the first thing I do in the morning, I haven't missed the day of TA since I started.
Uh-huh. So
17 months.
Do you feel like you're 52, or do you feel maybe better than you did, or how?
I feel like I always did. I feel like I was 16.
He is so energetic.
Really?
Yeah, I can work all day, but then the next day I'm really achy. But I guess it has to do with being 52, I guess.
And so you built a pool house, you carried all those stones and the fences and your house.
I make rock stacks.
On these white rocks, you see, he carried those rocks in a bucket down there. And these big rocks, which you see stacked, my husband stacks huge rocks, like sometimes like 10, 15 feet high, you know.
What?
He has an incredible...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's like Stonehenge.
We have them all around the property, and they are gigantic.
I like these megaliths. Yeah, so it really looks like a Taliesin Northwest type of deal here. It looks beautiful.
Yeah.
You built this house.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to get another angry note from my wife. So is there anything else you want to talk about in the TA realm?
I just hope that people know that this thing can do for people who have a terrible itch like I have, you know. Maybe people don't realize that that's one of the benefits of it, you know. Like, some, you know, we know Gil, other people who are taking it, they don't itch, so they don't really know. But, you know, this changed my life. I mean, this changed my life.
Well,
you know, even if I'm dying and I still have liver cirrhosis, and, you know, at least I can go out not itching, you know.
So let's talk about that. Why did it do that? Well, okay, first of all, the itching is not from the skin. It's from the bile salts. So the bile salts are getting cleared better by the liver cells. So the liver cells are getting repaired from being killed off by the apoptosis and being replaced by better stem cells, better mesenchymal stem cells. So that's why it would help the itching. I mean, there's a lot of reasons, steps along that link. So I'm not going to say that, you know, this cures all itching, but if you have hepatitis-induced pruritus, then, and it helps your hepatitis, then yes. But, you know, you still have a problem with your liver, a big problem. So let's not, you know, I'm just saying your titers are high, So maybe this didn't do a lot for your Hep C, but it's definitely doing something for your liver in general, right? Because you're clearing the bile salts, and that's purely a clinical observation. But lab-wise, you're still not out of the woods. So good. I think, do you have any other comments, Barbara? Thank you so much for sharing. You know,
it was very interesting. I enjoyed it. Thank you, Dr. Park.
That's my pleasure. I always like learning a lot, and your story is particularly interesting. But it's this, again, I have to say, this, the last chapter is not written, so we're going to revisit this. Because, you know, Hep C, hopefully your next biopsy won't show the degree of cirrhosis, but we need to get you all the way back out of this process. I mean, it's still ongoing, and largely I think a lot of it is the fact that the iron is just clogging up the whole system.
What I wanted to say is that his overall condition, you know, he was really tired before even he started the interferon. He had to rest in the afternoon for a couple of hours. When he was working, he got really tired. This is gone as well. Dr. Shima says, oh, you work one day and one day you relax. He can't do it. He has such an incredible energy. He is resting in the afternoon sometimes for an hour, but that's it. And we are always up until 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. You know, we go through photographs. So we do a lot, you know, and he is not tired anymore. He got a lot of energy, even if his liver results, the blood results show that he is not very well, but his overall well-being is so much better.
Well, I mean, certainly we're not just talking about the liver. I mean, his vitality in terms of his skin, his pancreas, his brain, everything is better. But the liver hasn't quite gotten to the point where it's cured, has it? It's just
exactly,
we need to get it to that point. I mean, the immune system is doing what it can, you know, certainly. But we got
that's amazing
more.
With your fingernails.
Yeah.
Your fingernails, literally, I have to cut them, like, every couple of days.
Right. So the telomerase activation is working. It's working in your nails, your hair, your skin, your immune system. And it's doing its best in Hep C. But let's remember, Hep C is a really bad disease. It's progressive. It almost always overwhelms people. So, you know, the fact that hopefully your bile salts are coming down means that some part of your liver function is recovering. But, yeah, I mean, you have ascites, you have a swollen belly. That tells me that you still have portal hypertension. It means that the liver is still not a clean organ. It's still a dirty sponge right now. So, but, I mean, you know, TA, I think, helps with everything. It helps rejuvenate and refurbish and, you know. But, yeah, you make a great point, Barbara. It's the quality of life is all that matters. And it's
he is not so sluggish anymore, if this is the right expression.
And now if we can just get the price down, we'll be in heaven.
Well, I think in a Buddhist sense, you guys are already in heaven. You guys are enjoying your life.
Are.
You're both. You're like kids in love. You have your own little love nest that you built. I mean, what's better than that?
Love.
Yes.
All right. Well, very good. I mean, I don't see any other questions. I don't see anybody wanting to jump in. So, yeah. Do you guys have anything else you want to add?
No.
That's about it.
No? Well, you're lovely people, and I really thank you for sharing all this with us. I think it was great.
Cool. Thank you so much, Dr. Pops. It has been a pleasure.
All right, guys. Yeah. Okay. Very,
okay,
very
have a
good.
Great day.
Thank
you.
Okay.
Hi, everybody.
Bye.
Have a great day.
I got flowers in the spring. I got to wear my ring. got you.